All right, I think we're live. Can you hear me?
Hello.
Let me crank up the volume here a little bit. All right, I think we're live.
Yep, we're live. I hear it. Hello.
I'm hearing feedback on my end. Hold on.
Do you have the YouTube stream open? Make sure you do
that. Yes, I do, which is probably the reason why we're having the thing. There we go.
Probably. Sorry about that.
Yeah, no, sorry, everybody, as we're getting the rest of things all ready to go. Let's see here. How do I get it where? Let's just pin me on here. That's what we'll do. All right. So, hey, everybody. It's Mac from Rev. We got Noah with us and Stephanie. We're going to have Frank joining us in a little bit here to try to answer some of your technical questions. So this forum itself is mainly around things that are going to be going around building a robot using the Rev kit itself, programming and some of the troubleshooting around there. If you guys have any questions that are specific around the game itself, around what's considered, like, let's say, field damage or what point values are worth or penalties or things along those lines, all those need to go into the control hub for the game specific questions. Basically, what we're here today is just to kind of get rid of or answer any questions that you may have that are around the technical side of the fence. So do we want to go around the horn and just introduce everybody that we have here for the time being? Sound like a plan?
Yeah, sounds good. Just another note. Also, I don't think you mentioned this. You can feel free to submit questions via the YouTube live chat, as well as through the control hub or the spreadsheet that was sent out. We're looking at all of those. To get to the YouTube live chat, you can just click the title if you're on the embedded page on the First Global live call site.
Yeah. It looks like we have some people tuning in from Latvia, from Russia, got some folks coming from Sawo. We're live here in Texas. It's very warm here today. We hear Frank coming down the hallway. There he is. All right. Sweater. Is it chilly in here? Is that? Oh, that's fine. I wouldn't worry about it. Just shut the door and we can make sure that we don't hit Brisco too much. All right. Anyway, so as we're getting ready and getting set here, so one of the first questions that I actually kind of tackle off jump, because we have a question coming in from Russia around their team having multiple kits for building a robot, and can they combine and use them as a second? What are they able to utilize from the second kit itself? So basically the way that the program works is all of the, you're able to use like one kit's worth of materials on whatever your final robot is. So if you have, do that. If you end up having a, if you have some spares around, you're able to definitely use those in that fashion. So like if you're building a mechanism and you happen to not do the math right and you blow up a gearbox and you need a spare, swap in a different motor and kind of go from there. If there are other things and other processes around the lines, you can definitely do that. And it gives you some options. Some a little bit better options on that end to know what you're able to have mainly as replacements. So that's really would be the added benefit of having an additional kit.
Yeah, but the bomb, you know, the total bomb is what you're limited to.
Yeah, so the total bill of materials that's on the original kit, that is what you're limited to for the game itself. So that's a good question to kind of start off with. Let's see here, what else we got here? One of the other ones, actually, this is probably a good one for Frank. We end up having where can we find the robot chain? So it's the rev part number is 41-1365 CAD file to use within your 3D design.
So the chain is an interesting one. What I recommend using is a placeholder file because if you were to actually model up the chain, each individual link will bog the program. So if you do a placeholder, and what you can do is you can just model the, you know, as a, almost as a rectangle, but as a curve, you know, just an extrude, right, of the curve that that chain will live in, that's what I would recommend you do. So instead of using a direct model for that chain.
Yeah, and the really big thing is that it allows you to be able to do your designs a little bit faster and is not nearly as resource intensive. There are models available that you can download, but if you've actually ever, chain itself is actually a fairly mechanically complicated 3D model.
Yeah, your average, you know, a link of chain is actually, 8 pieces. It's 8 pieces. And that's, you know, that's small and a large outside, right? So if you were to repeat that over and over and over, like for your entire length, that's a bajillion parts. So it really would bog down your CAD program. Using a placeholder assembly makes way more sense.
Yeah. So that's one way that you're able to kind of do that, use it and to make sure that things are aligned and in place, and being able to kind of click through a little bit quicker. That's usually the way that we recommend. It's even what we do with our own teams that we happen to mentor down here in Texas. So let's see here. We got that one. Oh, another one that we got was on corner cubes. So I actually have a little corner cube right here. So these were something that was put into last year's and this year's first global kit. And when you first look at this thing, it is a cool little piece of material, but it is kind of a little strange with how you're supposed to use it. So I already have. I'm going to give this to Frank so that he's able to attach one up here. So what you're going to want to do as he's doing this with some of the tools we have here is it's designed to actually get placed on the ends of the extrusion. So what you want to do is you want to take a screw, and on the end of the profile, there is the center hole itself. And you want to basically
thread it into that spot on the center of the thing. Now, a tip. So if you are using our nut driver and you put the screw in, you see how it falls all the way down. A trick to keep that from happening is to take a nut, and pop a couple nuts into the handle, and then you can pop your screw in and see how it pokes out. So then you take that screw and you get it started on your onto your extrusion, and it's sometimes a little tricky to get started, but once you got it going, it's easy. And you just screw it in. You're going to want to go slowly and back out every so often so that it doesn't bind up or break your screw. And once you've got it kind of started like that, then you're going to switch over to using your the corner cube. So once you've got that pre-tapped, you'll take your corner cube, you'll line up the face of the corner cube that you want to use. And what I like to do is I like to drop my... I like to preload my corner cube and my screwdriver. So I'll take my screwdriver, put the screw in, take my corner cube, stick it through. And there we go. A little tricky. There we go. Poking out. And then I attach it to my piece of extrusion.
Yeah. So one of the things that's really great with corner cubes themselves is it allows you to build in a little bit more strength for 90 degree joints. If you want to have additional strength as well, you can add an inside corner bracket. So these things will mate with each other. So if you kind of take your inside corner bracket and you were to take another piece of extrusion with a corner cube, you can have these where they will mate appropriately, and you'll have some extra rigidity into that system. So like, especially in like dry train applications are really, really good. Or if you're building like some large upright that's going to be going in an upward direction, having that additional strength is really, really important. And also the corner cube does allow you to build in basically on three faces. So you're able to go in three dimensions to kind of, well, finish your corner. It's
boom, boom, like any of those combinations. And you can do all three at the same time.
So it is kind of designed and set around to be able to do that. Frank did mention this, but we really want to highlight into this on any of the applications that you need to go ahead and tap a screw through the center hole of the extrusion itself. They are not pre-tapped. It is the tappable hole for an M3, but like using a basically what you're doing is you're going through and you're threading the interior of that with a bolt. So it's clearing away the aluminum of the actual channel itself, which can generate friction, which does generate heat. And it basically kind of the way that we tell a lot of the students that we work with is you do like basically a turn or two in and then do about a half a turn out. And then and you kind of repeat that process, slowly moving your way through.
And if you ever feel it like starting to get really hard, like harder than it's, you know, than it was when you were previously turning it, stop. Give it a minute, back it all the way out, grab a different screw and keep going.
Yeah. So, because basically what you don't want to have happen is that the screw itself shear and then basically now you're up for some fun time. You're going to have to figure out how you're going to get that out of there. And typically you need some more tools to be able to do that. Yeah. So just something to kind of keep in
mind. It pays to take your time when you're tapping the ends of the extrusion.
Let's see here. So we already kind of answered the question about components from previous year's kits. So you can use components from previous year's kits.
As long as the total number of components that are being used are what's in the kit of parts for this year.
So there's that. Another question we got was around the torque that the double-sided motor can withstand. So I'm going to assume that's the core hex motor, which I don't know if I actually have one in this room right now.
Yeah.
Here
we go. So the core hex motor is rated at 2.1 Newton meters, whereas the HD hex is rated at around 4 Newton meters. So it's about, so the HD hex is about twice as torquey as the core hex. And do they have the 20 to 1 or the 40 to 1?
The 20 to 1.
They've got the 20 to 1. Okay. So the 40 to 1 is about twice as torquey. So they actually have pretty similar. I'd have to, you know, let me check that number. But if you look on our website in the resources page and go to our motor guide, you can find all of those specific values for the HD hex and the core hex.
And also this is another thing just to kind of put out there. So there are a bunch of resources that are already put together specifically for First Global that are available on First Global's website, as well as them being mirrored on revrobotics.com under competition for First Global as well. There is a number of them there. There are additional technical resources that are on RevRobotics' technical resources tab that you can take a look at. Also kind of walking you through some of the basics that you need, especially like, for example, in the motor guide and in the gear guide, to be able to pick and choose what types of reductions that you may need to do off of the gearbox to continue to move forward, just to be able to build an optimized design for what your team is looking to achieve.
Yeah, and I recommend checking out the motor guide. It has a whole bunch of information that will help you kind of understand not just the torque of a given motor, but how to pick the right motor for your application.
Yeah.
So,
and I actually have the motor guide pulled up now.
Yeah. I saw that pop up and I was like, hey, that Noah coming in with the clutch.
The core hex motor has 1.7 Newton meters as its stall torque.
So the version of the core hex that they have, I believe, is 2 to 1.
Wait, what? Are there two different versions of the core hex?
Yeah, there's two different versions. The
I did not know that.
2 to 1 is the one that's in the global kits and is commercially available. So,
okay.
Yeah, the other one is a thing that we've been toying with for a little bit, but it's the 3.2 Newton meter is going to be the one that you're going to be going with. You're looking at a stall current at around 4 amps. and eight watts of maximum power output. The one real big thing is that this is kind of the nifty thing with between the core hex motor and the HD hex motor is the HD hex is running on a spur gearbox. There's a similar spur gearbox that is inside of the core hex motor. However, it goes into a right angled bevel gear, which is the way that we're able to get that female input as well as having it where you're able to attach to either end of the motor. It also accounts for some of the noise too.
So we use a specific type of gear in there that's really, really great for this application, but it's a noisy gear.
So this is also worthwhile in kind of being able to do any of your applications. So if you're looking at building an arm or an elevator or a ball shooter or, you know, a slingshot or, you know, a Ferris wheel, whatever it is that you guys want to do with this type of stuff, like for the competition and then after the competition is over, these motor guides, it can give you the type of information that you need to tackle whatever problem is in front of you.
Yeah. And if we can scroll up on the motor guide page, let's see a little more.
What are we looking for?
we're looking for the motor selection component.
Oh, there we go.
Selecting right a motor right there.
1.5.
So the section 1.5, if you're trying to pick a motor, read through this. It'll help you. If you have trouble following the math, talk to one of your mentors. And they can help you kind of decipher what's being communicated there.
But it is a good place to kind of be able to figure things out, especially if you start in the way that most folks do, and like even groups that we work with, you start by prototyping and you kind of take what you kind of have, and then you start working on optimizing your design, right? So being able to optimize your design with what you have, considering that you really have three different types of things to be able to drive motion between the HD hex, the core hex, and the servo itself. Those you kind of need to keep those into consideration when you're looking at designing things. You're likely not going to want to use a servo on like a climb, like that's probably not. But you probably could.
But that's the same exactly that same selection process that is reviewed in 1.5 can be applied to the servo. So you get to pick, right? And that picking process is important because you're limited, right? You don't have an infinite number of motors. So you want to think about what each motor is going to be best for.
So there's a couple of those things there. So we got the torque numbers. We got some of those other ones.
I'm going to jump in real quick. I'm seeing a bunch of questions come in about the game itself. How many matches during the day? Are certain things legal? If you have questions about the actual competition or the game, anything in the game manual, you can go ahead and post them on the First Global Control Hub. There's a couple forums on there. It's at hub.first.global. We can answer those questions there. We'll try to keep this call focused on the technical stuff. As for any questions of, are things legal? If it came in the kit, it's legal. If it did not come in the kit, then it is not.
It's usually a pretty good way of going about it. let's see here. One of the questions that we had that came in from Kuwait in the chat here is just like some general advice on being able to build robots. So generically, I think a really good one, at least within the rev system itself, is to what we call preloading your brackets. So a preloaded bracket would look like a non-preloaded bracket is something like here, like one of our linear motion slides. But when you preload the bracket, you put in the appropriate hardware beforehand.
Yeah, and you always want to do what we refer to as a stud up construction, which is where the screw is pointing up and you have the nut going onto the outside of the bracket. So then you take this and you can slide it onto your extrusion just like that and then tighten it down.
Mm-hmm. And so that's one of the really big ones that makes it a little bit easier to be able to run. Frank mentioned a little trick with nut packing the nut driver so that you're able to have
So it doesn't just fall in.
So your bolts don't just fall in, which kind of helps in those regards. Some other things as well is there's being able to support, so supporting your shafts is a really important one. So the way that the gearboxes are constructed as spurs, there's basically only one area of contact that is basically driving all of your power. So if you're not supporting both sides of the shaft or taking a wheel or gear and putting it as close to the gearbox as you possibly can, you can potentially be in for a little bit less than a good time and causing damage to the thing. I think this is also a pretty good time for, I know Stephanie mentioned some things about the competition itself, but with regards to anything that is happening with your robots themselves, if things do get damaged at the competition or they get damaged at your work site and they're absolutely needed for you to be able to get your robot up and running, we will have spare parts. There is a robot hospital. We do have volunteers that are going to be on board to make sure that your robot is up and running and ready to go. That's what we're really excited to see what you guys have been working on in about 6 weeks, right?
Yeah,
something like that. No, I don't know. We fly out of here in about a month, I think. I don't know. Something like that. But anyway, we're really excited to see what you all have been up to. But Frank kind of has an example here.
So like right here, you know, we've got the wheel as close as we can get it to the motor. And this is usually okay. I still don't recommend it. Really what you want to do is support the other side of your shaft. So here I've got one of the plastic bearings and then I've got a bracket and I support the other side. So I could build this into my robot mechanism. So when it's, you know, on the ground, the motor's supported, you know, with its motor bracket, and then the shaft is supported with this bearing bracket, or motion bracket. And this gets really important if, for example, you have the wheel all the way out here, then supporting the other side of this bracket is really, really important.
Yeah. So that's just one helpful tip just to build robots a little bit more reliably. The other thing as well, and this is actually more in NOAA's end of the camp, is with programming itself is using some of the internal sensors that are in the control hub and on the motors themselves. NOAA, do you have something on like utilizing blocks with some of the encoder with some of the cool features that are already built into the control hub and expansion hub?
Yeah, I mean, so when you're building a robot. And I put a lot of this information in the new motor encoder guide that I made for this year. In fact, I'm going to take a second and pull that up. If you could do that, Mike, that'd be great.
Let me pull that up for you.
Anyway, so we have the ability to either, you can just run the default mode when you, in blocks or Java, is just to run the motor at a particular power level from -1 to 1. And, you know, but that's influenced by factors like battery, you know, how much battery you have. If there's more load on the robot, it will go slower. So what we can actually do, is use either the run using encoder mode, which will use the encoder to keep a constant speed measured in ticks per second that you can set. So rather than using set power in this mode, you should use set velocity. And it'll account for battery level.
Friction, like other basic physical things that you can't
inhale. Exactly. All the physical things that you don't know at the time of when you're writing the software.
Noah, is this good for helping your robot drive straight?
It should help that. Yeah, it doesn't have anything crazy like making sure two sides of the wheels are exactly in sync or anything like that, but it should help your robot go straight. Now, if you're going to do this, there's two things. First off, with the HD hex motors, you need to set custom, and in this guide there's a description of that under using the HD hex motor.
Mm-hmm.
You need to set these special velocity PIDF coefficients because the ones that came with the software were incorrect. the other big thing, whether you're using the HD hex motor or the core hex motor, is that you need to update your control hub and or expansion hub firmware to the latest version. And I have another guide for that. There you go. Control hub and expansion hub firmware guide. It's not difficult. It's pretty simple. If you're using your expansion hub for motors, then you'll want to update that too, and you'll have to go to the store and buy a mini USB cable, unfortunately, because we shipped stuff with the wrong with old firmware. So,
and also when you come to the event itself, if you swing by the robot station, we'll be able to update firmware and do that type of stuff. So at the event. So if you're looking to be able to do this, we have the ability to do that at the tournament itself as well. If you can't get your hands on the appropriate cable to be able to plug it into a laptop, a computer.
If you try to set PIDF coefficients like I describe in the motor encoder guide, and there's actually better. This is just for like basic default values. I'm going to get into making your own values in a second. If you try to set those coefficients, if your firmware is the old version, it will act, your op mode will actually stop working and you'll get an error. I believe the error is, it'll say, if you're using blocks, your error is going to say, fatal error occurred while executing the block labeled call set velocity PIDF coefficients. And if you're using onbot Java, it'll say user code to an uncaught exception, unsupported operation exception, setting a PIDF coefficient not supported. So make sure you have your firmware updated. And then the other motor mode that's available is the run to position, which uses the run to the same coefficients as, you know, it reuses the run using encoder velocity coefficients. And you can still set your maximum velocity with it rather than setting power. But it actually targets a particular encoder position and it'll hold it there. So instead, so that if you have a, like, let's say you have a lift, instead of just saying, you know, drive, okay, stop, you can just say, hey, go to this encoder position. You'll want to make sure that you always reset your encoder to a known zero position, so that 100 is always this spot and not sometimes this spot.
And there are sensors that you're able to use to be able to make sure that you're resetting your encoders appropriately. So this is starting to get a little bit more into some advanced controls type thing when you're getting up and running. But like there, you can utilize like the touch sensor as an example. The distance sensors and a few others, you can come up with some creative ways to be able to do that. The one really great thing about the amount of stuff that is in that kit that you all received is that it gives you the opportunity of doing anything from very, very straightforward robots to be able to build everything with the control hub and expansion hub. You're able to really kind of run with it. So as you're getting ready for competition, you can kind of have some stuff to play with. And then once the competition's over, the fun doesn't have to stop. Like these guides and the product is still going to be there. You're able to still learn more things. You're able to meet some of these wonderful people from around the world that share a similar interest as you. Maybe even get to meet Frank and I and Noah and Stephanie at the competition as well. But it gives you guys a chance of being able to go back home and then being able to continue to play with this stuff and being able to show other people the things that you learned. I mean, that's real. The competition is fun, don't get me wrong. But a lot of it is like, you get to meet some really awesome people too. Is there some other stuff that you want to kind of highlight within the programming side of the fence?
Not really. You just left the,
yeah, sorry.
That's okay. Note that motor PIDF tuning guide link. Just read the motor encoder guide, read the motor PIDF tuning guide. And those are very conservative values. You might want to increase like your P value up a bit, what you'll get from that.
Yeah. And there's a bunch of other guides that are on here that help kind of be able to follow along with like what to be able to use different sensors for. And basically, the real kind of thing is taking like some of these things together and being able to kind of piece them in. So if you're utilizing run to position, as Noah was saying earlier, right, you're going to probably want to be able to have some way of zeroing your encoder. So finding an appropriate sensor to be able to do that is going to be an A plus type of a thing. Let me stop sharing that page and we'll go back to this. Let's see, what other questions do we have?
Well, there's a couple on here, quick ones about maximum dimensions and is the size of the robot standard for each country. The robot has to be in a starting configuration that fits within 50 centimeters by 50 centimeters by 50 centimeters, so a volume of that size. Once the match starts, the robot can expand outside that size. But this is standard for everyone. Every country has the same exact kit and the same rules, so you're all working towards the same requirements.
So just make sure that you're able to fit within the 50 by 50 by 50 centimeter cube at the start and then unfold into the massive machine that you want to be, or stay really tiny. You know, there are some advantages and disadvantages to all strategies.
Just because you can be a, half meter cube, doesn't mean you have to be. You can be as, as small as you want, right? As long as you're using legal parts.
As long as you're using the stuff in the kit, you can be as small as you want to be to achieve whatever you're looking for. I personally want to see what the smallest robot somebody's able to make and be able to play the game. It's one of my personal favorite things.
Favorite. There is no award for being the smallest robot.
Yeah, there is no award for being the smallest robot. You might be the number one robot in my heart, but that's an entirely different
thing. I'm gonna interject with a couple of questions just so we don't miss them that came in through the first Global Control Hub. I don't know if these people are actually watching live or not, but we have Austin posted an update to his personal feed, which, by the way, I'll take a second to address this. I've seen a bunch of people post questions on their personal feed on the Control Hub. And I try to respond to those and say, hey, these should really go on the forum. It's easy to be it's the first text box you see, so it's easy to just post your question there. Those are a lot harder to find for people, so we really want people to take those questions, click on the forums link in the Control Hub, and post them there. Anyway, so Austin has a question about Wi-Fi connection. The robot keeps disconnecting from the tablet whenever it's in use. Team Nigeria is having this issue. I don't know if you're from there, but I actually have a video call with them in the morning, and we're going to try to figure that out. So hopefully I'll be able to have an update for you, next week sometime. If what I find from Nigeria doesn't help me at all, I will get in contact with you and maybe you can get me some extra data about what's going on.
One of the other things as well is it's also a thing we are using what commercially available, like widely used Wi-Fi networks in the gigahertz ranges, at least here domestically within the United States and in Canada. So there might be some other interference that is happening within there. There are some tools, and NOAA's been kind of taking the charge on this to be able to help remedy these issues. So if you do run into some problems, please post them on the Control Hub. We have folks that are monitoring that to be able to make sure that we're able to keep everybody kind of going. And there are ways of being able to either change what channel you're operating on for the Wi-Fi connection, as well as if you're operating in what band you're also operating in. So we can try to find ways of optimizing it for what's going on at your home where you are, being able to solve that. We have a question about Rev Robotic shirts being for sale. I'm going to continue to raise this, but we'll see what we have. I know that we are going to have a bunch of swag and giveaways, like stickers and some other stuff at competition in Dubai. So please come by and see Rev. Hopefully we'll bring enough to be able to keep everybody relatively happy. I know I'm packing a lot of my suitcase is going to have stickers is what I've been told. So that's what we're going with. So we'll be able to kind of go there. Some Wi-Fi. We already kind of talked about the Wi-Fi stuff. Let's see here. We have somebody asking, why do we need the webcam in the kit? Noah, this is a wonderful question.
Yeah, that is a great question. So again, and I'll pull up the sharing this time. So if we go to the first global page.
So while Noah's doing this and he's doing some navigating, one of the things that there is a webcam that is in the kit itself. It's a Logitech camera. When you're actually utilizing that camera, it's really easy. You take your control hub and you're able to plug into one of the USB ports here on the top. So you're going to take this bad boy. You're going to go ahead and find a place to put them on your robot, and you just kind of plug it in and it is ready to go. And a lot of it is used for, it can be used for vision detection. There are some really interesting things that are baked in onto the hub itself. And I think Noah, you're about ready to.
Yeah.
That.
All right. So I realized we should probably clarify where exactly you find all of these guides. So you're going to go to the first global website, first.global, hover over first global challenge or click on it on mobile, I guess, and then click robot guides. That's the URL if you wanted to go directly. So under here, you're going to find the Vuforia vision guide, and this is what's going to let you use your webcam. So on the field, there's going to be a vision target. It's a world map. And you'll be able to see, and that's going to be located about at the mid-level of the barge. You'll be able to see exact placement in the game manual. So what we can do with Vuforia is it'll tell you where your robot is with in relationship to that target. And you can use that in your program to, for instance, line up at just the right distance and angle to hit that, to make, like if you have a shooter, to make your to make it into the goal every time using vision.
Or if you have like an elevator and you're picking up those big balls, you're able to make sure that you're like located in the right, you're located in the right area to be able to make sure that when you release your mechanism that they score.
Properly lined up and everything.
Yeah, and making it easier for you to be properly aligned. Because one of the things that I think a lot of folks don't really realize until you get to the event itself is you are standing away from the robot. One of the nice things when you're building at home, right, is you can chase after the robot and you always have a very nice perspective on the thing. But there's going to be a lot of other robots driving around. There's going to be loud music. There's going to be people cheering. You know, you want to try to be able to find ways that you're able to make it as easy as you possibly can on your drivers within your team's knowledge and expertise. And also, this is another fun thing that you can end up taking and doing later on is once the Vuforia stuff works with that specific global target, and you can then take that, you can print out a target, one of those targets, and you can utilize it to do some other really, really fun things. Like you can have it chase the target. You can have a robot chase the target as an example. So there are some fun stuff that you can do with this after the competition is over as well. It's a real that you can kind of continue to do some of your programming learning, maybe teach a younger sibling how to do it or somebody else in your community some cool techniques and some cool things that you learn. Like it's just the kit itself, we are slowly growing it to give more and more both programming and also mechanical expertise that you're able to kind of take this stuff and continue to grow with it.
Yeah, we want the only limitation to be your imagination.
Yeah, so that's the general goal. Let's see here. Got the Vuforia one. Let's see here.
So another one, the Wi-Fi connection issue from Norway. Whoever submitted that, could you send it with a little more detail so we can find out what your problem is?
Yeah. That would be good. We have a couple of questions that seem to be around elevators and or linear slides and some things of those like of that like. One of the things that we have is we have some pieces of our linear motion kit that are here to kind of be able to highlight some of this stuff. The linear motion kit itself is very, very flexible. You're able to kind of design and make it fit whatever you like. When you're building an elevator, usually it's what's considered a two-pole lift One of the suggestions that typically we have is if you need to build multiple stages, so a single, there's a post and then there's a stage that goes on the end of that post. So if you were to have two pieces, this is a one stage lift if it was in a linear slide of that type of an arrangement. But instead of you building, you basically build towards the interior of your robot. So that you have your
You always want to have kind of two, you want the lifts to work in tandem, right? So you don't want to just have a lift going on over here by itself. You want to have, you know, can you hold these?
Yes.
You want to have your other lift kind of working together with them, you know, connected to each other in unison. So that'll help keep things from tilting and binding on you. Another thing that that's important when you're using the linear slides is when you're putting them together, take your time in when you're putting them together and tuning them. So what I recommend, and you can read read more about the specifics of the technique in the linear motion guide that's on the Rev website as well as the First Global website. You want to leave them a little bit loose so that they can adjust to find the position that they like to be in, and then slowly go through and tighten the elements. And just tighten them lightly, and then tighten the other element a little bit, you know, and kind of go in this pattern where you tighten each portion of the lift sequentially and loosen them up a little bit, let them wiggle, you know, and tighten them up again and kind of go in that cycle a few times to get your motion sliding really cleanly. Another thing that you can do is if your lift is not carrying a lot of weight, you can remove the side flag and just use the internal slider. And I will point out another thing with the internal slider. The screw on the internal slider, don't tighten it down super, super hard. You want that screw to be just tight enough. If you tighten it super hard, it will make it harder for this for the piece to slide on it.
And one of the other things is as you're running these linear slides, they will get a little bit smoother over time. The plastic pieces do eventually will wear due to friction. So they will get a little bit more, a little bit less tight as they're kind of floating in space there a little bit. One of the things to kind of keep in mind is that if you, as Frank was mentioning, if you're building an elevator itself that is holding a lot of weight. So if you're trying to, let's say, build something maybe with those to hold on to that big ball, more than likely you're going to want to have those side sliders in. But if you're doing some sort of like light actuation that maybe is more like forward and back, you can get away with not necessarily having those sliders. And basically you're going to have to play with it yourself to be able to figure out how many sliders you need in different situations.
Yeah.
Another really big thing too is when the stringing is being done to do the double, you need to basically have them coming in together into a single motor, more than likely that is going to have some sort of pulley that you're kind of wrapping things around.
And with the lift, for that first stage of your lift, you know, the first portion that moves up and down, you can do that in a lot of different ways. String is a great solution for that. You can also use chain. You know, if you look at pictures of robots last year, there's some pretty cool chain implementations that you can see. You know, I recommend kind of looking at pictures of other robots, both from First Global in previous years and First Tech Challenge, to kind of get ideas for how things can be built. Also look around your community. You know, you can take ideas from, you know, real industrial equipment and, you know, toys and all that sort of stuff that you see in your day-to-day life, and kind of bring those ideas into your robot.
Yeah. So different tools that are being used within your community, you can definitely find inspiration in how to be able to build things that work well for your machine. Perusing.
And I see a question here about building a high speed one. So the tricks for the high speed is you want smooth motion, right? And then you want to figure out the gear ratio that you have for your motor. So, you know, for high speed, you want to be using the probably, you know, you got to do your own math, but you probably want to be using the HD Hex. And then you want to figure out the exact ratio that makes sense. And I'll refer you back to the motor guide. And that can help you figure out exactly the right gear ratio that will help you move as quickly as you can.
Let's see here. So we have just a couple of things around trying to suss out some Wi-Fi connection stuff. We're waiting to get some more information around that. Linear lifts. Robots, two-wheel or all-wheel drive? That's a large question. So in reality, this is actually going to come down to what your team is looking at getting. There's also a very large, there is a split in belief on what are kind of the best ways of being able to drive robots. One popular method is still using six wheels, but you have two Omni wheels in the front and the back, which allows you to kind of spin and have some good turning. If you have a heavier load and it's like loaded to one side of the robot or the other, you may want to replace one of those Omnis with a traction wheel and then being able to tie them together to drive.
Yeah, it really is up to your team what y'all think is better for four-wheel drive or two-wheel drive or, you know, whatever. It's play with, you know, different solutions, and there are, you know, pros and cons to both. You know, the two-wheel drive is really easy to implement. It's very controllable. It's very reliable. You know, a four-wheel drive or a six-wheel drive system is more complicated. And so it, you know, it might be more of a challenge for your team to build. You know, it's really up to you and your team.
And one of the things that at least you want to be keeping in mind when you're building, and this might be things that you've already come into across with your own teams, is that if you're utilizing multiple traction wheels, you're going to get what we call scrub. You might not see this so much at home, but on the carpet that you're going to be on at the competition itself, as the robot kind of turns one way or another, that rubber is kind of getting skidded across a plane.
Wheels like going this way, right? They like moving in that direction. They don't like kind of going sideways. So that's why we include the Omni wheels.
So it's one of the reasons why we have the Omni wheels. There's also some tricky things you can do with what's called a drop center. So you can kind of, you can add washers or spacers onto a pillow block or something like that to be able to lower your middle wheel to be able to get a little bit of rock, which then will make scrub. It still exists, but it makes it a little bit less of an issue because of it changes the math basically.
Yeah. We have a drivetrain kind of concept guide on our website as well. Mm-hmm. And the for the drop center stuff, check out the adjustable motion bracket. That's one of the ways that you can get that drop center. Mm-hmm. Let's see.
So there's somebody's having some issues with the joysticks being with the tablets.
I have not heard of this issue. When they originally, they posted their question twice. And the first time they said that it works fine when they use a phone instead of the driver's station, instead of the tablet that they have. Mm-hmm. It's really weird. If you would please email support@first.global, we can try to get some more information about what might be going on there. If you know how, you can send us your driver station logs. That being said, if the phone works, you can just use the phone, and I think we should be able to make sure you get a new tablet at the event.
Yeah, right? and we can work on solving some.
Yeah, we'll work on the issue, but don't feel like you have to use the tablet right now. If a phone works, it's gonna work, and it's fine to use it for practice. We won't let you be frustrated at the competition.
Yeah, that's definitely not something that we want to have happen. One of the other questions that we have in here is utilizing of other motors for gripping or faster rotating motion. So you need to use the DC motors that are in the kit. So that's basically the core hex or the HD hex motor. The other opportunity that you have for an actuator would be the smart robot servo. The smart robot servo can be put into both a continuous and servo mode or servo mode. So you can use it at, like you would a motor. If it's geared appropriately, you can gear it a little bit faster to be able to get some more speed. But those are really the three actuators that you're going to be utilizing.
So to answer the question, no, you cannot use other motors, only the ones that are in the kit. Mm-hmm.
We got a question about welding the aluminum frame. Is that one we want to save for the game Q&A forum?
Yeah, I would put that into the game forum. I will say that with the extrusions itself, this is not an official answer for whether it's legal or illegal for First Global. I want to just put that, we're going to put that out there right now. I am doing it. Welding aluminum itself is already a very, very tricky and hard thing to do. And then the extrusions, they're already anodized, so you need to be able to take that anodization off. And then B, there really isn't a whole heck of a lot of I'm going to use it's the term, thin. There's not a lot there. And it's not, there's not a ton of meat as a way of kind of putting
and especially with welding aluminum, you know, one of the things that you have to worry about is burn through. And when something is, you know, thin like this, it is very, very difficult to weld that without burning through. Yeah. So I don't recommend it.
I don't think you're going to have you're not going to have as good of a time. And also once you weld something in place as well, you know, it's stuck there. You can't change it. You can't adjust it. It needs to be that thing, which is one of the things that's really nice about the extrusion is you can kind of loosen a couple of bolts, slide some things around if you need to be able to change it, and then tighten them back down again. You can keep running.
Yeah. And you know, the first time you do something, it's probably not going to be right. And that's okay. That's the design process. You know, you have to be patient with yourself and patient with the project and try different things until you get the result that you want. If you lock yourself into something prematurely, it'll be really frustrating because it won't do what you want it to.
Yeah. And I think we have time for a couple more questions. We have one around weight affecting our robots in terms of functionality. So yes, weight will, and where weight is located will also have terms of functionality. So it's going to impact your center of gravity of the device, especially when going up that ramp. If you go up that ramp and you have a very, very tall object that has a lot of weight, it's likely going to fall over. So that's one thing for you to kind of keep in mind. Also, weight is something that takes an impact with power for how much you're able to move with motors and other actuators.
Yeah, acceleration, you know, the heavier you are, the slower you're going to accelerate. You know, you'll eventually get to top speed, but, you know, eventually it might be a bit slow. So, you know, thinking about weight and not just total weight, but where that weight is important.
Yeah. So that's something to kind of keep in mind.
But because you're only allowed to use parts that are in the First Global kit, you know, there is maximum weight for the entire robot, maximum possible weight for the entire robot.
So it looks like there's another question in here about resoldering the cables included in the kit.
Yeah, so I know that we have, so within the kit itself, You can, I actually don't know, that's a legality question, but I do know that inside of the kit there are 4-pin joiner boards for the sensors themselves. to be able to kind of connect to make those a little bit longer. And you also have cables that are up to 100 centimeters long for both that and also your motor power. Again, this is on a question I think this kind of plays into the one of weight as well. If you're the motor length is 100 centimeters and your starting configuration is 50 centimeters, if you're looking at needing to extend
all the way across and back,
if you're looking at extending a motor that far of a distance away from where your actuator is or where your control hub is, with an understanding that you need to have some space for, some strain relief for wiring and also where your control hub might be living on your robot. Likely you're going to be running into, you're potentially going to be running into issues where your center of gravity is going to get thrown off. Some of the heaviest items that are in the kit itself are physically the motors. The motors and the battery is really where a lot of your weight's going to be, which means you're going to want to try to keep that down low and even in down low and probably over your center drive wheel, depending on the specifics of your design. But generally speaking, you kind of want to keep as much of your weight as you can, as low as you can, to prevent your robot from tipping over and being on its back.
Yeah.
And as far as the wires, rule 5 in the game manual addresses the modification of wires versus motors and servos, which you may not modify at all. That's all on page 14. So rule 05.
Thank you, Stephanie. So that answers that.
We have a question about the T-screws. Any tips there?
So they slip in, sometimes they slip in the extrusion. So
yes, this is something that you have to be aware of. When you're using the T-screw, let's say we're gonna use it on this bracket right here. We'll of course preload it, just like we recommend for using all of our screws. You'll take it and you'll line it up, drop it in. And what I recommend doing is to kind of push the nut towards the side. So like if I'm pulling it like this, I'm pulling that nut over. So then I tighten while I'm sort of pushing it over to the side so that it has a better chance at grabbing a hold of the side of the extrusion like that.
Yeah. And the other thing as well is with the drop-ins, they are really, really handy for being able to add something to your robot. One of the real big tips that we have is usually it's being able to plan ahead is a good one. If you know that, for example, we actually did, this was for a prototyping build that we did for the First Tech Challenge program a couple of weekends ago. But if you're building a drivetrain as an example, and you know that you're going to need to build up at some point, but you wanted to give, your programming team some time to be able to get an autonomous routine together, and global, there's no autonomous, but you wanted to start doing some of your programming, right? It is beneficial to be able to pre-feed in some of the screws, so then you're able to then set brackets just on top of that area and get your connections going.
Just like what Mac was saying, if you're not sure if you want a bracket somewhere, you can just put some extra screws in there. If you later decide that you want to put a bracket in, those screws are already there, so that it's a little trickier to get that bracket on, sure, but you can kind of line them up and jiggle that bracket into place and then put the nuts on top.
And kind of go from there. So there are kind of a couple of major ways of being able to kind of build with the system. Leveraging the side of the slot of the slots that are in the extrusion is helpful for when using the T-screws, but wherever you can, try to preload a couple of things in there, especially if you know that you're going to need it.
You have a lot of screws in your kit, putting 2 or 3 or 4, 6, extra screws somewhere that was like, maybe we're going to have to change that. Dropping a couple extra screws in is not a big deal.
Yeah. And yeah.
And if the noise of the screws annoys you, you know, if they're rattling around, you know, kind of while you're driving around, you can just put some nuts on them and tighten them down, and they won't rattle anymore.
Yep. And be able to hold them in place.
Yeah.
It looks like, I believe.
Actually, I just remembered one more that I wanted that I thought we should address. On the earlier, today or yesterday or sometime, someone posted on the Control Hub forum, what's the purpose of the hollow polyurethane round belt?
Yeah.
So I don't have one that I can grab right here. But the polyurethane round belts with the pulleys, the point of those is primarily as a conveyance system. So if you wanted to, say, take some of the pollutants that you've collected and move them to a different part of your robot, you can use the polycord to do that movement, you know, as like a conveyor belt.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually what they're used for in real life too. So you can do, say, two of them or three of them, four of them, whatever, you know, any configuration you want to move a pollutant around.
Yeah. So mainly it's being used for things like for intaking, conveyor belting is another major one. The one thing just to kind of keep in mind with the round belt itself is that since you are inserting a barb in the end to kind of hold the two pieces together, is to make sure that you have the right amount and that you tension it appropriately. Yeah. So this might need to be something that you kind of play with your own team to be able to make sure that you get the tension just right. Yeah. Usually this is a reason why I personally like to have of three pulleys in there. You have one as kind of your drive, the drive pulley. You have another pulley that's sitting usually somewhere where it wants to start your conveyor. And then you have a third one that sits somewhere in the middle that you're able to move kind of in a north and south relative position.
Yeah, to add tension.
To add and remove tension as you're kind of going to make sure that you're able to, A, keep the right amount of compression on your game element, but then also on those pollutants, but then also making sure that you don't pop a belt at the wrong time.
Yeah, and on the point of popping a belt, you want to make sure that that your polycord, that the forces that your polycord is experiencing are directly towards your pulley. If you have lateral forces on your polycord, it makes it much more likely for that polycord to pop off of the pulley. So you want to make sure that everything is, you know, pushing straight into that pulley.
But it looks like that looks like most of the questions that we have.
And on that straight into, if you've got your pulleys kind of out of plane with one another like this, the belt is going to pop off. So you want to make sure that they're in line with one another.
It's similar to when you're playing with chain.
Yeah. Exactly like that.
Right.
I see there's one more in here. Do we need to worry about cooling down the robot?
So you probably don't need to. One of the things to kind of just generally keep in mind is there is going to be, your limiting factor in reality is going to be.
And the time limit.
And the time limit. So within the competition, you should be okay. When you're practicing at home or you're driving around in your own workshop, usually our recommendation is that about every battery swap or so, you give your robot a little bit of a break so that the DC motor can cool, mainly because you're going to be utilizing them in a little bit more of a forceful manner there than you will be in the at the competition.
Yeah. You know, each match is, you know, what?
A couple minutes.
Yeah. 3 minutes long or so. So you're not going to make your battery or your motor super hot at time, but if you're practicing, you know, in your shop for 45 minutes, an hour, yeah, they'll get a little toasty. Take a break, you know, talk to your teammates, you know, think about strategy, and then, you know, then get back to practicing.
Yep.
After your motors have had time to cool.
So I think that's about as much time as we had scheduled for this. as well as it looks like we answered most of the questions that we end up having. There's some folks that if you can follow up with us, just as actually generally speaking, support@first.global is a really great resource for some specific, if you're running into some specific issues. Also, please post questions that you have on the Control Hub. We do have staff members from First Global, as well as some folks from Rev poking in to try to be able to answer some of the questions as they come up. And otherwise, you guys have anything else that you got you want to be able to say, or any questions that you guys had that we needed to answer?
I'll just say thanks for all the great questions. It was a good stream. Thanks everyone for joining us.
All right, so that's for us here in Dallas, Texas. Somewhere also in New Hampshire, and I believe DC.
I'm in Rhode Island.
Rhode Island. Oh, geez, we're all over the place. Anyway, all over America. We're gonna see you guys at the competition. We'll in see you guys in Dubai in like what, 6 weeks, something like that.
Yeah, it's gonna be it's gonna be a lot of fun.
Yeah. All right. So we're signing off for now. We'll be able to see you guys shortly, soon.
Bye-bye.